We now want to consider the unsteady flow problem. When the flow becomes unsteady, the symmetry between the upper half and the lower half of the plane gets broken, and we have to consider the full range of the polar angle. To do that, we still need boundary conditions on theta, and the boundary condition we're going to use is called periodic boundary conditions. So let me show you how that works. If we draw our domain, and this is not necessarily the cylinder, but this is just some circle with the cylinder in the center. I can illustrate the periodic boundary conditions. So this is X and this is Y. So to implement periodic boundary conditions, we know that the flow field is periodic in the angle theta, because after theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, it repeats itself. So the boundary condition we can use is to start one grid point below the 0 angle. So this will be our first grid point. And then when we cross the x-axis here, this will be our second grid point. There are m grid points in total, so we're going to go around and finish on the x-axis after m grid points. So this first grid point will also be our m minus 1 grid point, and the second grid point will also be our m grid point. Okay, we say that the first grid point and the last grid point are what's called ghost points. So J equals 1 and J equals M are what we call ghost points because they're repeated, right? So the first grid point is the same as the M minus 1 grid point. The second grid point is the same as the M grid point. So these are our boundaries. We have the polar angle sub J then is going to start at minus h. So it will be j minus 2 times h when j is equal to 1, meaning starting at minus h, 2 to m. Okay, so that will be our polar angle. So what are the boundary conditions? So we want a boundary condition on the stream function. This is for all of the radial coordinate points and the first point in the theta angle. That's going to be equal to the stream function for all the radial points and the m minus 1 point in the theta angle. So this is our boundary condition on the first value of theta. And the same is true for the vorticity. Okay? What about the last value of theta? So psi for all the radial points at the last value of theta is going to be the same as the second value of theta. So psi of I comma 2. And the same for the vorticity. Okay, so those are our boundary conditions for the first theta value and for the last theta value. Okay, what is our H here? What is the grid spacing? So we know that we have M points in theta, and when we go around M points, we should get to 2 pi. So we know that 2 pi then has to be equal to m minus 2 times h. After starting one below, when we go around m points, we need to end up at 2 pi. So that gives us our value of h. So our grid spacing in this case is going to be 2 pi, now no longer pi, but 2 pi divided by the number of grid points we choose in theta minus 2. Okay, let me summarize. Because we're solving now the unsteady flow problem, we have a broken symmetry between the upper and the lower planes. In fact, we're going to be simulating vortex shedding. So a vortex coming off of the upper half of the cylinder will be followed by a vortex shedded off the lower half of the cylinder. So there's no symmetry then that we can exploit to reduce the computational domain by 2. So we have to solve for the whole computational domain. To still have boundary conditions in the theta angle, we choose periodic boundary conditions. So the first grid point in theta is going to be the same value as the m minus 1 grid point in theta. And the m grid point in theta is going to be the same value as the second grid point in theta. And that gives us our 4 boundary conditions. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.